Everybody get up.
Music. The name of the song we played was the hit song Blurred Lines by Robin Thicke and Pharrell. And today we'll be discussing a recent copyright infringement case involving that song. And to help us discuss the case, it's my pleasure to have attorney Bob Clarida on the show. Bob is a partner at Reitler, Kalis, and Rosenblatt and is widely recognized for his intellectual property expertise. He's the author of the treatise, Copyright Law Desk Book, and the principal author of the annual review of copyright decisions published each year by the Journal of the Copyright Society. Bob also co-authors the copyright law column in the New York Law Journal and teaches a seminar on emerging intellectual property issues at Columbia Law School. Bob, welcome to the Future of the Music Business.
Great to be with you, Steve.
Bob, before we start discussing the case, let me give a brief intro. Robin Thicke and Pharrell co-wrote and had a huge hit this summer with Blurred Lines. In the U.S., the song topped the Billboard Hot 100 for 12 consecutive weeks, becoming the longest-running number one single in 2013, and it also sold over 5 million copies in just 22 weeks. The song has engendered two major controversies, however. The first one involved a video and some of the lyrics from the song. The video was released in March of 2013 and was made in two versions. The first video featured three models dancing around Thicke, Pharrell, and T.I., who performed on the track, and in the first video, the models were topless. The second features them covered. The topless version of the video was removed from YouTube in March for violating the site's terms of service. And some complained that the video was misogynistic because it showed the models topless and had lyrics that included the words, "You know you want it." Well, that controversy has basically died down. But on August 15th, the Thicke camp started another controversy by suing Marvin Gaye's estate. Now, what's that all about? Well, members of Marvin Gaye's family, two sons and daughter, felt that Blurred Lines sounded too much like Marvin's Got to Give It Up, and that it basically feel that the song was infringed. Now, it's been widely reported that the Gaye family rejected a six-figure settlement offer from Thicke's camp to settle the matter. And then Thicke and Pharrell decided to act preemptively by filing a lawsuit in August in the U.S. District Court in Los Angeles against Gaye's estate. Now, they're not suing for money. They're seeking a declaratory judgment that Blurred Lines does not infringe the copyright and Got to Give It Up. Okay, with that intro, I want to discuss with Bob the mechanics of the case, as Bob is an expert copyright litigator. The purpose is to give you, the listener, a feeling for how these kinds of cases actually unfold. So, Bob, let me start by asking you, what happens next? I suppose Gaye's estate will have to answer the complaint, or is it possible that parties will settle even before that time?
Well, a number of things are possible. I mean, yes, always possible that a case can settle any time, any day, if parties get on the phone and work something out. It's always possible to settle a case, and in fact, that's how most cases get resolved. Most things don't go to trial, and they don't even get to summary judgment in most cases. Things usually are resolved by agreement because it's just frankly a lot cheaper and a lot more it's a lot more certainty that way. You know, you don't roll the dice so much.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I understand that there was a lawsuit filed on August 15th. I'm not sure if it's been served or not yet. There's a difference between filing and serving a lawsuit.
Mm-hmm.
When you file a lawsuit in federal court, that doesn't start the clock running for anybody to have to answer it. What starts the clock running for the answer is when the complaint is actually served on the defendant, you know, by formal service process with it.
Right.
You know, just like, you know, someone going out knocking on the door and and serving, or you know, can be by agreement you send it to their attorney or something. But there's another step required after filing a case to start that clock running. And basically, after you file, you've got 120 days. You've got, you know, really 4 months before you actually have to serve the thing. So it could just be that the suit has been filed but not served. I don't know.
Uh-huh.
I haven't gone and checked the docket sheet. But if it hasn't been served yet, then the clock hasn't even started running for a response. Once this complaint is served, then there's 20 days to respond unless the parties agree to more time. And the response could take the form of an answer, but it could also take a couple of other forms too. Could be a motion to dismiss, for example, because in a declaratory judgment action, which is what we have here, basically you've got the accused party, the accused infringer, Robin Thicke, who has started the ball rolling in court and said, I want a declaration that I'm not an infringer. You can't always just bring a declaratory judgment because somebody's been saying bad things in the paper about you. There has to be actually what the court considers a real controversy, a ripe controversy, that is, litigation is imminent. And if it's not, then it could be that we're going to see a motion to dismiss this case because the gay estate will be saying, well, yeah, we talked to the press, but we were never going to sue these people. It's not like we had threatened a lawsuit. Now, if they had actually threatened a lawsuit, and maybe they did, I don't know the facts of this case, but if they had actually threatened a lawsuit, hey, Robin Thicke, we're going to sue you unless you pay us a lot of money, then there is a real controversy, and the declaratory judgment would be proper in this case. It's also entirely likely and quite probable, in fact, that if there is an answer in this case, there would also be a counterclaim by the Marvin Gaye estate where they would say, okay, we're going to now sue you for copyright infringement. Since you have dragged us into court for a declaration that you don't infringe, we're going to sue you for infringement. We're going to file a counterclaim. So that's what I would expect to happen if the case doesn't settle. There will either be some kind of motion to dismiss or an answer and a counterclaim.
Well, let me ask you about the motion to dismiss. If they do that, then, in other words, they're stating, well, we had no intent to sue. And if that is stated, are they barred from filing for copyright infringement later on?
No, they wouldn't be. Although it would certainly be hard for them to explain. Gee, you know, now you've got an opportunity to take this case to court. You know, are you going to contend that this song is an infringement or not? And I think at that point, it could very easily be an estoppel to prevent them. Although, you know, that's a very gray area of the law,
right,
about when you're estopped from bringing a claim. Because there are all sorts of reasons that you might say, well, I think it's an infringement, but, you know, I have 3 years to bring an infringement claim. You know, so why are you going to force me to do this now?
So, assuming that they don't settle immediately and they don't file the motion to dismiss and they do the counterclaim for copyright infringement, then what happens? Does the court tell them to, hey, get in a room and try to settle this? Would the court possibly appoint a mediator, or what happens next?
That's very often what a court will do because judges realize that most cases settle. And it's better for the judges if they can settle sooner rather than later, because then, you know, the court doesn't have to waste a lot of its resources, overseeing a case that's not eventually going to get resolved by the courts anyway. So most courts, and I'm sure the courts in California where this case is happening, will try to push the parties into mediation as soon as they can to try to get the parties to resolve it, although that's a voluntary process. The courts cannot force you to mediate for the most part. So if either side says that they don't want to go into mediation, and there may be some tactical reason that they wouldn't want to, then it doesn't have to happen. Also, I know in some district courts in California, and I'm not sure if it's in the Central District or the Northern District or wherever this case is pending.
Los Angeles.
Central District. Some of the district courts in California have what they call early neutral evaluation, an ENE process. It's similar to mediation. It's where the parties get together and there's a court appointed neutral who will just say, look, I'm going to tell you what this case looks like and how it's going to play out. And it's just a sort of an agent of reality to say, look, you know, get the stars out of your eyes, everybody. This is how this case is going to play out. And I, the mediator here, don't have any particular stake in the outcome. But, you know, this is what it looks like. And this is, you know, it is an evaluation of your case. And in general, the purpose of that is to get each side to think their case is not as strong as they think it is, and to increase the uncertainty on both sides, which tends to push people towards settlement. If they think, I might spend hundreds of thousands of dollars on this lawsuit and walk away with nothing at the end of the day, they're pretty receptive to the idea of settling.
But just to be clear, the mediator has no power to make the party settle.
That's right. No, it's a voluntary process. And generally speaking, if the court orders it into mediation, the parties will go, because you don't want to get the judge irritated. And you want to look like you're being a responsible citizen and all of that.
Mm-hmm.
But sometimes mediation is just a complete waste of time. And if the parties aren't committed to do it, very often it is a waste of time.
Well, let's talk a little bit inside baseball in terms of psychology. I think, we all know from watching plenty of television that some judges seem to like publicity. And a judge here could say, well, this is going to get a lot of attention and could be an opportunity for me. Is that a possibility?
That's possible, sure. Sure, I suppose so. And, you know, this is certainly the song was a big hit and has been in the news a lot, you know, even apart from this dispute. And, you know, it wouldn't surprise me that a judge might see it as an opportunity to get his or her own name in the papers. But, you know, judges in Los Angeles have no shortage of high-profile cases to get involved with. This is not certainly the only celebrity case out there on the docket, I'm sure.
Well, from a copyright infringement point of view, it's certainly really interesting, which we're going to get into in a bit. I just want to talk a couple more minutes about the mechanics, because I find this fascinating. So suppose there's this counterclaim for copyright infringement. Suppose they go into mediation and they can't settle. Okay, then what happens?
Well, then typically there will be a schedule set by the court for discovery, which involves exchanging documents, the parties, having occasion to take depositions of various people on both sides, and usually that process is at the minimum several months, and it can stretch out over a year, depending on how complicated the case is. Also, in the course of discovery, would have reports and depositions by expert witnesses.
Uh-huh.
Most music infringement cases do involve expert testimony. If the question really is down to the similarity of the musical compositions, almost invariably you will have an expert witness in that situation. And that would be part of the discovery process, is there would be a schedule for what are called fact witnesses, which would be the people who wrote the song and, you know, maybe somebody from the record label talking about what the sales were. And, you know, you'd have accounting information and all that, so the real factual basis of, you know, how the song was written and how much money it made and all of that. And then you would have expert discovery. When the fact discovery was concluded, you would have expert discovery, in which each side would put forward an expert who would put in initially a written report and then would sit for a deposition, and there would be rebuttals to all of that. So that process takes a while.
Mm-hmm.
And from the time that all plays out, once discovery is fully closed and there are no more fact or expert witnesses to be deposed and all the documents have been exchanged, at that point, one or both sides would almost certainly move for summary judgment.
Right.
And summary judgment is a way of saying to the court, this case is so clear that it doesn't have to go to a jury. You know, the facts and the law can lead to only one conclusion here. No reasonable juror could find in favor of the other party. And very often, in a case like this, both sides would make a summary judgment motion.
Mm-hmm.
The main advantage of that is you can get a decision a lot faster than having to go through the whole pretrial process of getting a case ready for trial. You can save a lot of money, because the pretrial process and trying a case can be extremely expensive.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a lot cheaper in most instances if you can write a summary judgment brief. That's not a cheap process either, but it's a lot cheaper than putting a case through trial.
Right, because all of this would be in avoidance of a jury trial. There would be no jury for the summary judgment decision to take place.
Right, that's right. That's a decision that the judge makes on summary judgment. And essentially, the judge is trying to put him or herself into the shoes of a juror and say, if I were a juror and I were given the proper jury instructions and I heard this evidence, would there be any way that I could come out, in favor of either party, or would I have to come out in a particular place? And copyright infringement cases are very, very often resolved on summary judgment. There are exceptions, but jury trials are really rare in copyright. I remember reading a statistic a few years ago that in the course of a year there were 12 jury trials on copyright infringement in the whole country.
Oh, wow.
So it really happens extremely rarely that a copyright case goes to a jury.
But it's not so rare for the party against whom the summary judgment comes down to appeal, correct?
Oh, right. And that happens very routinely also, because if the court decides a matter on summary judgment, then the Court of Appeals is looking at it essentially what's called de novo, because it was answered, the question was answered purely as a question of law. And the Court of Appeals says we're in as good a position to answer a question of law as the district court was. And so there's not going to be any deferring to the district court's fact findings in a summary judgment context. Because that's another aspect of summary judgment. If I make a motion for summary judgment against you, I basically have to say, as a condition of my summary judgment motion, that I'm assuming that all of Steve's facts are true and everything Steve says is right. And then, notwithstanding all of that, I still win. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
So basically, to make a summary judgment motion, I have to concede for purposes of the motion that everything you say about the facts is true. And if I can still beat you, even accepting all of your facts as true, then it's a summary judgment case. If there's a fact dispute and I can only win if I win this fact dispute, then that's something a jury has to decide. So
right.
Because of that, when it goes up on appeal, the summary judgment will be accepted, affirmed on appeal, unless the Court of Appeals thinks there was really a mistake of law made below, not a factual mistake.
Okay. One last question about the litigation process. Suppose the Court of Appeals says the lower court was wrong, made a mistake of law, and it goes back to the trial court or the district court. Does that mean there'll automatically be a trial with a jury at that point?
No. Usually what they'll say is, we remand, the Court of Appeals will say, we remand this case for further proceedings consistent with our opinion.
Mm-hmm.
And they won't specify what that is. Although very often it is to go back and have a jury trial. And at that point, the case would probably settle because the parties would have a very clear idea of where the law was. And they might be very reluctant to spend a lot of money on a trial, if there was summary judgment granted and that was, if it was remanded for fact finding, it could be that the Court of Appeals would say, hey, there are facts in the record that the district court didn't really consider, and we think there are factual disputes here that need to be resolved by the fact finder, and we're going to send it back. And typically that would then go back, and there would be a trial. Now, not every trial is a jury trial. That's the other thing.
Oh.
The parties can elect to have a trial in front of the judge.
Do you think that Marvin Gaye's estate or either side might have an interest and if they got to this point, wanted to spend the money, a jury, because the jury might be more sympathetic to one or the other?
That's always, a matter of trial tactics. And certainly there are lots of instances out there in which juries have made surprising decisions and people are left to speculate, well, was it because they just felt sorry for the defendant or, felt sorry for the plaintiff? They had a personal connection with somebody. And that's always possible. And certainly trial lawyers try to make the most of that opportunity if they think they can do it.
Well, I don't know how well endowed the estate is, but Thicke and Frill is certainly making a lot of money from the song.
And that could make it a very, excuse me, a very attractive target for a lawsuit like this, because if an attorney were to take this matter on contingency and get, you know, some percentage of the recovery here could be very large. If you're entitled to get the entire sales proceeds of Blurred Lines, that would be a big number.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, a lawyer who might get 25 or 33% of that would stand to do very well.
Yeah, not only 5 million units sold, but the licensing for commercials, movies, it's like indefinite.
Great. Well, and then the other thing is, if you win the case, you would almost certainly get an injunction, a permanent injunction, which would mean that there could be no future use of this song without your permission. So that could be a huge amount of leverage that you would have to get the Robin Thicke folks to pay you a big chunk of money to dissolve the injunction.
That reported six-figure offer could jump to perhaps even seven figures. But
it could, and that's why a case like this is going to be very attractive to some particular plaintiff's lawyers, because there's such a large potential payday. Even if the odds against winning are pretty large, the payday is so big. It's like buying a lottery ticket. Probably not going to win, but if you do, it could be a big,
especially
a big
because the Thicke camp has already made an offer. So it makes sense that they're willing to settle at any point. Very attractive for a lot of attorneys. But now that we've talked a lot about the process, let's talk a little bit about the substance. And in order to do that, what I'd like to do now, Bob, is let's play 30 seconds of Blurred Lines, followed by 30 seconds of Got to Give It Up, and you, the listener, can make up your own minds. But actually, before we do that, Bob, just give us a sketch, an outline of the test involved here. For there has to be substantial similarity. So what does that mean?
Well, the Copyright Act doesn't explain what that means. And the Copyright Act doesn't even talk about substantial similarity. Copyright Act says that you cannot either reproduce the copyright owner's work or make an unauthorized derivative work of it. And the standard that the courts have developed for determining if you have reproduced the work or made a derivative work is a substantial similarity standard, where basically it's phrased as there has to be a substantial similarity of protectable elements of the song. In the case of a music case, music infringement like this, it would have to be, in the ears of the lay listener. There have been a lot of cases going back to, people suing Cole Porter back in the 30s and so on. This is popular music, certainly. It's judged by what a lay listener would think. It tends not to be things like, the songs have the same tempo, they're in the same key, they both have the word baby in the lyrics. That's not going to do it. It's going to have to be a fairly high level of similarity, because basically a lot of pop music sounds like other pop music. There are fairly limited repertoire of melody, melodic figures and chords that get used over and over and over again in pop songs. And particularly when you get into a genre like R&B that Thicke is in, there are certain things that are R&B devices that are in a lot of R&B songs, and the fact that they're in some Marvin Gaye songs and they're also in Robin Thicke, they're also in 100 other R&B songs, so that's not necessarily evidence of copying. Now, in the Ninth Circuit in California, where this case is, they also have this idea of an intrinsic similarity test and an extrinsic similarity test. And one of them you can actually have expert testimony about, to say, what are the formal features of the music that are similar? And you would get an expert musicologist to stand up in front of the court or the jury and say, well, they both have, an 8-bar phrase followed by a 4-bar phrase, and the melodic line goes from this note to that note, and the rhythm goes like this, and the pitches go like that, and the chords go like so and so, and they map that all out, and they say, look how similar that is. And the expert can do that, but at the end of the day, the expert can't determine is this substantially similar or not. The expert can point out these formal features of the music, but they have to say, at the end of the day, it's a decision for the lay listener about whether that all adds up to an infringement or not.
Okay, talking about listening, now let's play 30 seconds of Blurred Lines, followed by the Marvin Gaye song, and you, the listener, can decide.
Everybody get up.
Now, let me ask you if you can take off your lawyer's hat for a minute and think like a lay listener. What do you think? Potential similarity?
I don't hear it, frankly. I mean, yes, there is a lot of similarity. No question about it, there's a lot of similarity, but I don't think it's really substantially similar in a copyright sense. And I have to say, if I were on the jury, I would not find this to be an infringement. Yeah, there's a lot of similarities, but they're not things that are so striking or unique or unusual that it's only these two songs that have those elements in common. Now, I haven't gone through, this is another thing that expert witnesses often will do in a case like this, is they will find other examples of songs that have these same characteristics in common. And I'll bet you that a capable musicologist here could find a dozen songs that have a lot of these same features in common. So that makes it harder to win the case because, you know, who's to say that Marvin Gaye owns that particular figure? You know, where did Marvin Gaye get it? You know, because chances are it was in a song before he did Got to Give It Up. So, you know, if it's not original to him, then he can't stop somebody else from using it down the road.
Right.
Copyright only protects the things that are original to the author. And if Marvin Gaye didn't originate
right.
that bass line, he's not going to be able to stop somebody else from using it.
Right. Now, I'm writing a paper on this, so I took a look at a couple of cases, and I think the only shot legally that the Gaye Estate has is that the items that are similar may not be protectable in themselves, like the crowd noise that precedes both songs, and also the falsetto voice that both Thicke and Marvin Gaye use, and the beat and the drum rhythm, they may not be individually protected, but the combination that Marvin Gaye created in the first place, that if Thicke is deemed to have taken that same combination, even of unprotectable elements, they may have an argument for substantial similarity. What do you think?
That's an argument that I would make, certainly. And there are a lot of cases out there, and I have litigated some, where the plaintiff has put together essentially a combination of public domain elements, none of which individually are protectable, but the way the plaintiff puts them together is new and protectable and not something that was inevitable given the style of music they were working in or whatever. And that certainly can be protectable. In the visual world, the courts often talk about the look and feel or total concept and feel of a piece. And I certainly think that would apply in a case of music as well. It's the idea of compiling unprotectable elements into a particular selection and arrangement. There's a Supreme Court case that talks about protecting the selection and arrangement of
right.
elements. And certainly that would apply in a music case. It's a Supreme Court decision and it applies to everything. And, you know, that's an argument that I think you would have to make here.
Right. What case was that, by the way, the Supreme Court case?
The Supreme Court case is called Feist against Rural Telephone, and it had to do with compiling White Pages telephone directory.
Okay. All right. Now that we've discussed the complicated issue of copyright infringement, I'd like to raise another issue that's in the complaint. Thick lawyers is stuck in the complaint without explaining exactly why, that the gay estate has no standing, that is, no right to sue for copyright infringement. Now, I think that the reason for that, although they didn't state it in the complaint, is that there's a clause in almost every songwriter publishing agreement that gives the publisher the exclusive right to do various things. Basically control the songs, to collect the money, to make deals, and to sue for copyright infringement. Now, that right is exclusive to the music publisher, and Marvin Gaye's publisher was EMI, EMI was subsequently purchased by a consortium, including Sony ATV, and Sony ATV is now the administrator of the Gaye song. And the funny thing about this, although it may not be funny for the gay estate, is that Sony also has a piece of Blurred Lines through its deal with Pharrell. So, in effect, Sony ATV controls both songs and is making money from both songs, and as far as we know, has made no claim against its own songwriter, Pharrell. So, there's Marvin Gaye's estate out there alone. If they do sue for copyright infringement in their counterclaim, I think they may be barred for lack of standing because only their publisher could do that, and obviously Sony ATV isn't going to do it. What do you think about my analysis?
I think that that's a pretty compelling analysis there, Steve. I don't know the mechanics of who owns what, but you know, taking your facts as true, certainly a contract clause like this that you're talking about, where the songwriter assigns away all existing or potential causes of action and claims with respect to the publisher's acquired interest in the composition. I mean, the songwriter could very easily maintain what's called beneficial ownership if they were continuing to get a royalty stream from the sale of the songs. Even if they assigned the copyright outright to the publisher in exchange for royalties, they could still have what's called beneficial ownership, and they could have standing that way. But if you have affirmatively assigned away in a contract, you say, I am assigning to you the exclusive right to pursue copyright infringement claims and to, you know, receive and retain the proceeds from copyright infringement claims, then, you know, that's a contract issue. That's not a matter of, you know, what the Copyright Act does. And it, generally speaking, contract terms like that are going to be honored by the courts and respected by the courts, even if they take away some of the rights that a songwriter would ordinarily have under the Copyright Act.
Uh-huh.
And that's what every time you license a song, basically, you're saying, well, I could sue you for infringement by doing this, but if you pay me money, I won't sue you for infringement, even though under the law I have the right to sue you. You know, so certainly there are cases out there in which songwriters, that, you know, any copyright owner can give away rights that they would otherwise have under the Copyright Act. And the only exception to that, really, and it's an exception that proves the rule, you hear that expression a lot, the exception that proves the rule, but I think it really is the case here, termination of songwriter agreements or any copyright owner's agreements after a certain period of time. You know, statute allows you to take them back. And those rights that a copyright owner has cannot be given away by contract.
Uh-huh.
And the statute is very clear. You cannot assign this right to anybody. This is an inalienable right of the copyright holder, and no contract that purports to assign it is going to be enforceable. But the statute has to really say very clearly that you can't do this by contract. And in the course of case of something like this, giving away your right to sue as a beneficial owner, the Copyright Act doesn't preclude anybody from doing that. Now, it's also true that you can't give away just the right to sue. You know, there was a series of cases out in Nevada with this company called Right Haven. It was just getting the right to sue and going out after internet people, you know, who were, this is about newspapers, not a music case. But it's clear from those cases that you can't just give somebody your right to sue, but if you're assigning exclusive rights to them, and you, as part of that you're giving them the right to sue, then that's going to be honored by the courts. And so I think it would be very difficult for the gay estate to assert standing in a situation like that, if in fact they've given away these rights.
But doesn't the publisher have a fiduciary duty to the songwriter to protect the songwriter's interests?
They probably do, but you know, I don't know how it's you know, that would be a difficult argument to make, to say that you can't. You know, you can't own a song. You know, the publisher certainly owns all sorts of songs that compete with my song. You know, if I'm if I have you know, EMI is my publisher, they certainly are looking out for a lot of other songwriters too, and
including including Pharrell,
including Pharrell, right?
EMI / Sony, right?
Right. They have a fiduciary obligation to Pharrell, you know, to you know, exploit his catalog
and protect his interests. So it sounds like this argument could knock the estate out of court, but let's go back to the mechanics for a minute to wrap up our conversation. How would this issue be litigated? Because I imagine you'd need discovery to see the contracts involved.
Yeah, probably you would. And you would need some discovery for that, and the court could order some kind of expedited discovery. You know, the parties could request some kind of expedited discovery to get this issue dealt with very, very quickly. It's not something I think that, I guess Pharrell could presumably get his, if he has a deal with EMI, he could subpoena EMI, you know.
Give me that again, because Pharrell's deal, I think, is with Sony ATV, but Sony ATV now controls EMI's songs, including Marvin Gaye's song. So, repeat what you just said, because I need to hear.
Well, no, I think you know, even without going through the discovery schedule in a litigation and getting it from the Gaye estate, they could subpoena the publisher for that, you know, and say we need to get these contracts here. I don't know that it would, you know, shorten the discovery process much, but it could. And you know, if that kind of language is going to be dispositive in the case, the court will certainly want to get it out there sooner rather than later, and will not want to have, you know, a year of discovery arm wrestling, you know,
sure,
if there's a document like
well,
that.
Well, you know, if I'm Robin Thicke's lawyers, I want to see that contract as soon as possible if I haven't seen it already, and try to knock the estate out of court, and then they go home without anything.
Well, although, you know, If you're Thicke's lawyers, you've already got them in court. You know, you've already, you know, commenced this litigation, so you're ready to be in court with it. I guess what you want is to say, you know, I have commenced my declaratory judgment action, and these people cannot sue me for copyright infringement because they don't have any standing.
Right.
And if you could get a declaration to that effect, yeah, as you said earlier in the interview, you wouldn't even ever have to get to the substantial similarity question.
Yeah, well, that could be devastating to the estate.
And that could save an awful lot of time and money in discovery right there, because you don't have to get the experts, you don't have to do all the depositions. You know, you could just have some very focused discovery on this standing question.
Well, I don't know. I'm almost feeling sorry for Marvin Gaye's estate at this point. But, so there's some part of me that hopes my analysis is wrong. Because, you know, I think they should at least have their day in court if they want it for copyright infringement. And it'd kind of be a shame to actually walk away with no money after the Thicke camp has offered to settle this for six figures. And finally, Robin Thicke has said repeatedly that he owes Marvin Gaye a great deal in terms of his career, because he's imitated Marvin Gaye's style for years. And I know style is not copyrightable, but there is a moral debt, and I think that Robin Thicke would agree to that. So it kind of would be a shame if they didn't get something out of this, but that's just my lay opinion.
Well, right, and you know, and whatever Robin Thicke thinks as a person may end up being influential in the way this gets resolved, because this may not be a situation where the lawyers control the client, you know.
And very often
in litigation, that's what happens, is the lawyers take over and start driving the bus, and that may lead to a really different outcome if the artist is actually making the decision.
Well, hopefully this will end in a way that's satisfactory to everybody. But I think that our discussion kind of shows that there may not be a court decision at the end of the road, but I guess we can live without that. There are enough copyright opinions already.
That's the other sort of lesson to take home from this, mm-hmm. is, you know, mm-hmm. you see in the paper every day, oh, somebody is suing somebody over something.
Right.
And as a copyright attorney and a litigator, I tend to disregard that, because until the court actually decides something, it's just somebody putting a piece of paper in the courthouse. You know? And anybody can sue anybody over anything. And there are a lot of lawsuits filed that never go anywhere. And, you know, it always makes for a big headline if there's a celebrity involved. But very often these cases just kind of fizzle out. And, they don't actually end up making any law. And I would be quite surprised, actually, if this one, you know, gets to the point of a court decision about anything. But if it does actually reach the standing point,
mm-hmm.
that could be an important decision for other cases down the road, because, as you say, that kind of clause is really commonplace in publishing agreements.
Right. Well, I really appreciate your expertise. You've answered all my questions, and I hope our audience has learned a lot, too. Bob Parada, thank you for being our guest on the future of the music business.
Oh, great. Thanks for having me, Steve.